Hi, everyone, and thank you for attending to my speech about building reactive applications using event-driven architecture. First of all, we will be discussing about the reactive applications and what kind of reactive applications that you are finding usually. Reactiveness is a design of the nature. So this is a funny picture. Probably you have enjoyed reactiveness since you were children. In this picture, you can see event and the change of a state triggers the reaction based on the state. Different parties execute different activities in different flows. Event source doesn't care. This is the concept that we have taken into software industry when we think of building reactive applications, which means one event can trigger many reactions, and the event source doesn't have to coordinate all the reactions or the execution flows of multiple parties. The event source just creates an event. Based on the event, there is a state change. Based on the change of the state, different application components can have their own reactions, and they can basically invoke multiple invocation flows. And this is something you would find in day-to-day life when you go through some common web applications. This reactive design is commonly used in UI designing. Probably you have observed with single-page applications, web applications, when you are changing a value in a certain field of the web page, parallelly, it keeps editing or modifying some of the components of the same page. In this picture, you can see there is a text box called auction price, and there is a chart which actually depicts the price of different cars available in this particular auction, and there is a data table underneath. And once you keep editing this text box, by the time you edit this, edit the value of this text box, it continuously keep modifying the values in the graph as well as the table. So in this case, what we have, what usually we do is we keep we keep a representation of this view, which is a logical state object. What happens underneath is we have configured these UI elements in order to listen to this state object. Once you are changing one particular UI component or the value of one particular UI component, the state object is being manipulated. And based on the change of the state, the rest of the bound components of the UI keep being changed. You can see. The event is basically triggered in this picture on this particular text box, and the state change happens. The logical representation of this particular view, which would represent all the values as fields, and reactions can be observed in the chart as well as in the data table. So this is something that I took as a reference so that you could get the idea when we take the same concept into middleware-based software applications or platforms. And basic qualities of a reactive system has been recognized to be responsive, first of all. The responsiveness is what we see as the objective of developing a reactive software application. Basically, this is the client experience that we try to deliver by adapting reactive design into software applications. And scalable and resilient nature is the design quality of these reactive applications, because it is not just a matter of reacting to user interactions. Basically, whatever happens within the infrastructure or where these software has been deployed, and if there is a sudden increase of demand, basically this solution or application has to scale and be resilient enough to fix the errors itself or launch some kind of auto-healing mechanism and deliver the same experience that it's supposed to deliver. And the foundation of reactive systems is the message-driven nature or state-driven nature. Just like I discussed with the earlier slide, this particular reactive application has to react to a change of state somewhere. So those are the four known qualities that we can describe under designing reactive systems. If you are wondering why we need to adapt reactive system over some imperative or command-driven systems, these are some reasons. Because if you think about imperatively designed or command-driven systems, basically they are highly coupled. If you have to distribute components of the same application in different places, and when you distribute components, basically you will have to deal with response times. If you have to invoke everything sequentially without executing actions parallelly, basically you have to wait or you have to depend on the latencies delivered by each and every software component. If we think about reactive applications again, the message-driven nature is the reactive change of states. Because if we only discuss about event-driven architecture, basically event can be something. It can either be a message or it can be just a notification. But when we think about reactive applications, basically by definition, we have to start with the change of states rather than triggering some kind of an action based on some kind of an event. Enterprise solutions can benefit by adopting this concept, especially in a distributed deployment of hundreds of smart network endpoints. Which means today, if you think about today's applications, by nature they are most likely smart endpoints. So over the network you are executing some kind of a functionality using APIs or some kind of a endpoint provided by these parties. Inside, whatever happens, you don't even know. You just have to deal with some endpoints following their own security mechanism, and you just have to pass some messages in order to get something done. So when you have these kind of distributed application components, basically, you cannot follow an imperative design because you don't know, or otherwise you have to know everything about how these software components should execute the actions, which is not practical in a distributed deployment architecture. A single change of state in reaction can trigger many different sequences of following actions. So this is what we try to achieve. This is something about the smart network endpoints described about. The communication between and among independent systems, which see each other as black boxes through the network, which is the quality I just described. And this requires a universal communication mechanism, such as HTTP style API invocation, or common messaging, or otherwise, you will find some streaming APIs that you have to deal with. And we will be discussing about what event-driven architecture is. So this is a simple breakdown of the known patterns that can be recognized under event-driven architecture. The first one is event notification. The second one is event carried state transfer. Third one is event sourcing. And we have another one called command query responsibility segregation. So I will be going into details when it comes to event notification, event carried state transfer, and event sourcing. The command query responsibility segregation was avoided purposely because it is nothing but just establishing two communication channels in order to send the request and get the responses in some other event-based channel. But it is depicted in somewhere. So these are some sources that I have used in order to get this information, or otherwise to have this the four patterns listed under event-driven architecture. So you can follow these URLs. Those are really nice references. This is a typical command-driven or imperative design that you can find in many software application scenarios. First of all, you can see this particular tenant or some resident is applying for an overdraft through an online banking app. And it actually, this banking app has to have all the knowledge about the execution flows within the connected systems. So it keeps doing some kind of a service chaining where it should call the credit profiling system in order to evaluate the credit profile of this resident of this particular address. And based on the result, it actually creates an overdraft request in the core banking solution of this bank. So it's a service chaining scenario. There is an orchestration part needs to happen within the online banking app, which is a dependency, which means the person who develops the online banking app has to know what is happening within these two systems, and there is a dependency. So, or responsibility that online banking app developer has to take. If we think about the event-driven architectures, this is the first event-driven architecture pattern that I have listed in the previous slide. There you can see this tenant is just applying for an overdraft, and the online banking application creates a notification, event notification, which is an overdraft request. And this request is published into a common messaging channel, which has been subscribed by credit profiling system and the core banking system in this picture. So you can see as the qualities, the online banking app doesn't need to aware of the existence of any other related systems, which means it doesn't basically need to know about the credit profiling system or banking solution. If you introduce some other component into this picture, even in that case, you don't have to modify your online banking application. The third application has to be developed in order to listen to this particular messaging channel and execute its flows accordingly. And it doesn't need to control what should happen in any other related systems. So it doesn't have to worry about the payload format and the response formats of the rest of the solutions. And it doesn't have any overall understanding about the complete behavior of the entire message route and all the activity flows. It can either be an advantage or it can either be a disadvantage from the governance point of view. But it is what you get with this particular pattern. And let's say now this one of these solutions need to get some information or details from the online banking application in this picture. In that case, what needs to happen is in this picture, you can see the core banking system, based on this event that it has taken previously, it requests some more details from the data sources of the online banking app, which means the core banking system has to initiate a request in order to get the exact details that it would require in order to execute the rest of the flows. Because the event notification is just a notification mentioning that I have received a request for an overdraft. Based on that, the rest of the connecting components have to communicate and get the details. So that is what you get with the first pattern, what we call as event notification pattern. And then we have event carried state transfer, which is the second pattern that comes under event-driven architecture. There you can see this event is not just a notification. It contains some details. So the state is carried by the event in this picture. So we publish the entire payload into a common messaging channel, which is listened by the credit profiling system and the core banking system. So based on the most important fields or values that each and every system needs to preserve, they can have their own data silos so that they can get the state object or state message at once and extract the important elements and save them within their own data repositories. So you can see the data is replicated in different places, but it's a good way to avoid the dependencies that you might have. Because in this particular architecture, each and every unit is operating under its own control. It doesn't have to go back and forth in order to get any other details from any connecting party. And the third pattern is called event sourcing. This is a completely different application of event-driven architecture, but I chose to put that here as well because there can be situations which we can complement this particular pattern using the technologies that we are using today. So here what we do is we develop the online banking application to just log the events. First of all, once a request is arrived at this application, it logs what needs to happen within this particular flow, which means it logs an activity flow within its own local cache or local data source, which is a permanent data source, by the way. And then based on those events, it creates the application state, which means it executes these actions by reading the log that it has written into its local data source first. So after that, all the steps of creating or making an OAuth request are being executed within the application, and then it will communicate with any other systems and get things done. After that, your process is completed. The good thing here is, let's say now there is something wrong with the latest transaction that you have made. So you need to reverse this. Or otherwise, this flow was broken at some point, and you need to replay this. Or otherwise, your audit department is they are requesting you to provide an audit log about a particular transactions. So in such cases, this kind of an execution flow can become useful. So this is the third pattern that we have described under event-driven architecture. This is somewhat different from the previous two applications of event-driven architecture, but still this is a good pattern. And this is a reference architecture about the implementation of event-driven architecture. You can see, first of all, you will see the API gateway because in most of the organizations today, all the requests are being routed through a particular API gateway, which is a known pattern now. And then you have function as a service modules, which you can develop using something like microservices architecture. And you can see there are four applications in this example. The first application is just acting as an event producer, where it keep producing events and publishing them into different messaging channels. And the second application is acting as an event producer, as well as an event consumer. And the third application is just a consumer of some events in the same event bus or messaging channel. And the fourth application is a stream consumer. So you can even consume events from different sources or messaging channels in the form of streams, where you can perform some kind of filtration or some manipulations over different streams that you are receiving, and publish the output as another stream into a different channel. So those are things that you can do when you're applying event-driven architecture in real software development. So these are the technologies that you can use in order to complement this event-driven architecture. First of all, you can see at the API gateway, I have listed API, WSO2 API manager, which is not that relevant to this topic, so that is why it is being grayed out. And at the back, you can see the enterprise integrator and other brokers like Kafka. Those are the tools that you can use in order to have your messaging channels in the form of topics or queues. And in order to develop these reactive applications, who would act as event producers and event consumers in this case, can be developed using the technologies like Ballerina, Node.js, or similar technologies such as Spring Boot. And they can be deployed on containers like Docker, managed by technologies with like Kubernetes. You can find a lot of choices under this in order to develop reactive applications using event-driven architecture. So some people say life is all about making choices, and the harder part is to live with them. So WSO2 has given a choice that you can live with, which is called the Ballerina. So we will be discussing about how to use Ballerina effectively in order to implement this kind of event-driven or reactive applications. So in the picture, you can see the application delta, gamma, and beta. The second, and fourth applications are basically reactive applications, as I listed in the diagram. The first one is avoided because it only acts as an event producer. Basically, it doesn't. It is not being triggered by any event available in a different messaging channel. So event with a state message, message-driven nature is the foundation of reactive applications, just like I described earlier. So if you go back to the picture, these three applications are basically being triggered by events or messages, state messages. So that is why it follows the principles of event reactive applications. And basically, I described that these applications could be deployed on Docker containers managed by Kubernetes kind of container management solutions. So serverless architecture makes it highly scalable and resilient, which, I mean, those are two qualities that you find under designing of reactive applications. And overall experience is responsive because it responds to the change of state, responds to the load, also responds to the error. Because in this kind of infrastructure where you have all the functional modules developed using a technology like Ballerina and deployed on containerized infrastructure, basically these are highly scalable, highly resilient, and responsive to the load and they basically immutable, which means you can just kill these functional modules and spin up new copies of new functional modules of the same image. Yes, so this is about Ballerina. So I think you heard a lot of things about Ballerina throughout the day. So I have just summarized some information here which can be used under event-driven architecture. So Ballerina is a cloud-native serverless, cloud-native language which supports serverless kind of architectures and mainly focused on integration, which means when you integrate streams or messaging channels with your solutions using reactive functional modules, this can be used very effectively. And this supports common messaging data formats like XML or JSON natively. And this Ballerina supports stream processing and implementation of PubSub kind of architectures. This is a sample code which you can use in order to create a broker client using Ballerina. So you can see these are just basic parameters that you have to provide, which you might use with any other language. with the help of some third-party libraries or client libraries. But with Ballerina, you don't need to have client libraries. The runtime provides these capabilities natively. And when it comes to stream processing, you can see this kind of syntaxes are very known among UI designers because when they use JavaScript frameworks in order to implement or basically to avoid the usage of callbacks, they prefer this kind of syntaxes. You can see there is a function bound into the subscribe method of this stream that we have created with the name of employee stream. So within this subscribe function, you have we have listed print employee name function. So this stream will be listening. I mean, once you get events through this stream, for each and every event, an action will be executed based on what you write within this particular function. So this is a very known application. If you know about UX designing and the latest trends in JavaScript world, but it has been taken into middleware as well. And with this, it's pretty easy to handle streams. So these are natively supported. And when we think about performing any kind of a manipulation or joining multiple streams in order to do some pattern matching or analyze trends, you can use Siddhi query language or streaming SQL within Ballerina. This is also natively supported. So similar to how you would write an SQL when you try to join records from multiple tables or query information from many tables, you can use this language in order to perform the same with data streams, basically, the real-time data. So this is also natively supported. Which means when you are trying to build a reactive application using event-driven architecture, I would say Ballerina is the best fit if you compare the latest technologies available today, because you don't need any support of third-party libraries. You don't have to combine any other binaries. Basically, these are natively supported. And we talked about the resilience nature and the scalability that the reactive application should deliver, because those are two main points under the principles of creating reactive applications. So you can see these interesting annotations. So this is just a Ballerina program, and once you have to deploy these Ballerina programs in Docker containers on Kubernetes managed infrastructure, This is what you have to do. You just have to declare the services service in order to receive the traffic from outside, and the pods can be declared with the second annotation called the Kubernetes deployment. So once you add these annotations with the relevant informations like the number of replicas, you just have to build this using a single command, and if you have Kubernetes and Docker installed. Basically, it spins up the running instances automatically, and you will have a running setup within milliseconds. So when it comes to deployment on Kubernetes and Docker, this is also natively supported by Ballerina. So it's a perfect fit when we think about the qualities or what you would expect from reactive applications.